everyone. I am Tim Samet. This is a picture of me about a month ago sailing in San Francisco on a friend's boat, which is actually better than having your own boat, is having a friend with a boat. This is me about 25 years ago with my father, who introduced me to computers about 10 years before that. And you can see that my internet experience, much like Brett's, was this text window up in the upper right, where I was playing a game called Trade Wars, not actually on the internet, pre-commercial internet, using bulletin boards and modems and so on. But pretty quickly after I was having that experience, I learned about and then turned to something called Linux, and then FreeBSD and NetWare, which were ways to connect computers. And I had been connecting with people online a little bit, but this is a way to connect computers, and this is something that I really sort of dove into. I loved it. It was such a passionate way for me to learn, to find new ways that I could learn about new things as I decided, right, as I found and explored and moved on. But the important point was that I was having the internet experience that I wanted, right? I was learning about things. I was finding them. And my father was directing me a little bit, but really, you know, this was a new area for him as well. He didn't know about the internet. He didn't know what was out there. But he was helping me and find a way that I could learn more and more and more to keep myself going. And my children are having that experience today. My 11-year-old daughter has a blog called The Wandering Jellybean. It's where she's writing about things that we do as a family, travel and so on. And she's also learning a bit about privacy, right? Because the blog is completely anonymous. So she's only known on there as The Wandering Jellybean. Her friends make comments. They don't talk about their names. They're having the experience that they want via this medium, right? My 9-year-old daughter's learning to program. I get totally different internet experience than Maya, right? This is what she wants to do. This is what she's going through the internet as she moves forward. But not everybody can have that experience, right? This is Freedom House's Freedom on the Net 2015. You can see that much of the internet is partly not free or completely not free as rated by them in just 2015. And this is a huge landmass of the world, but also if you look at the parts of the world and how densely populated they are, there's a tremendous amount of people that don't have that experience, right? They don't have that choice about how they can learn and explore and connect with people in their own way. So also, as this was sort of developing in my mind, and I was going from being this kid on the left in somewhat unfortunate picture to having some cool experiences in the corporate world, there was another problem that was really starting to bother me as well. And I started calling this the security gap, if you will. And it's this idea that on the left-hand part of this, we've got corporations and security companies that are producing really high-tech, really advanced, really sophisticated security technologies to protect the work that those organizations are doing. But if you're an individual on the right, if you're maybe an individual activist, a human rights defender, or somebody else, those things are completely out of reach, right? And depending on what part of the world that you're working in, the threats that are coming at you are as severe, if not more so, than are facing the corporations in another part of the world. And that really started bothering me, right? How can that be? How can we leave these people over here that are doing world-benefiting work in an essentially unprotected space? So what was I going to do about it? And along comes this opportunity to actually focus on this, to step away from the corporate world where I'd been for quite a long time and actually work in this space for about 10 months. And I apply. And I get it, right? Go me. And go Andrea and Drew and Paola and Jem and Tennyson. We got it, right? This is fantastic. But now what? Right? I've been on the periphery of these problems and trying to help as much as I could and volunteer, and it just wasn't enough. So when I started at Amnesty, Sharif did this really fantastic thing, and sorry, Sharif, but it was a bit annoying at the time. He set up probably 20 meetings with me and individuals from around Amnesty just to talk about technology and what they were facing and learn about their work and so on. And I must have got asked 4 or 5 times, can I use Skype, right? Which from a security perspective is a terrible question. Of course, the answer is it depends, which is a terrible answer to give somebody who's actually trying to get their work done. So we came up with something called the Secure Communications Framework, which I'm not going to talk about too much, but it's a way for people to understand the risk, starting from the risk of what happens if this information became public, to who their adversaries are, to get them to a set of tools and practices. And it's really simple. You can draw it on a piece of paper, as I did here. But you can also do it on a slide. You can do it in a workshop and so on. So it was really successful, and HRW wants it, Internews loves it, and actually Access Now is using it right now for some of their internal work. But I think more importantly, I stood as an equal as part of the team, and for this I really thank Sharif. I came and I learned a tremendous amount about human rights, but I could talk and say, hey, what about this technology thing? Could we use technology over here to help solve this problem? And it was very much a peer relationship and an equal among the team, and that was really fantastic. Outside the team, I was able to participate in quite a few forums. meeting organizations, some of which you might know of, ASL 19, the Tor Project, and so on. And I listened, and I learned quite a lot. And then I participated, and they started listening. And it was really pretty fantastic. And along the way, I learned some things. Technology is a tool, but it's not the only tool, right? I mean, if you try to hit every problem with a technology nail, you're going to fail. And that's, in some ways, I knew that. But this really solidified it in my mind, and I think it's an important thing to sort of view technology in this space as an important factor. So from that, I sort of developed this thing that, in my head, I sort of called the three-headed dragon of technology and NGOs, and I'm terrible at drawing dragons, so I drew arrows instead. But it really starts with this idea that technology, in a lot of cases, is about sending emails. It's about printing. And that's not where technology adds value. I mean, it does, but not the real part of the value. Then we've got tech-centric issues like surveillance. But really, I think, in my mind, a lot of value comes from when the technology can be a peer in the other conversations. How can technology help the refugee crisis and gender issues? How can it be a tool? How can it do it? And it doesn't have to solve every problem, but it might help in a lot of problems, right? To just have those open conversations. So at the end of my fellowship now, I wanted to make a couple of points. One is I really, 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 really wanted to stay in this space, and I just couldn't. Right? I talked to a few organizations along the way, and they said, yeah, this sounds great. You know, come move to Washington, D.C. Come move to Berlin. Come move to Northern Africa. And you know, I'm not at the point in my life where I'm going to do that. And I see this as if there's this thirst for having seasoned, knowledgeable people in the space, there needs to be some flexibility, I think, on both sides. Right? We need to know that not everybody can live in California, where I live. But at the same time, people with 20 years experience aren't going to move to a place where they don't have their homes and their families and their social networks. Also, I think that the internet, the open internet, helps people really be who they are, right? It helped me learn about technology and do different things. And the open internet is incredibly important. And for that, the mission of this program is absolutely important. Thank you.